Okay, good evening, everyone. My name is Mike Weber. I'm the president of the IWP Alumni Association, and we're here today to have a lecture in honor and memory of Brian Kelly. He was a professor at IWP who passed away several years ago, and the Alumni Association have set up this this lecture series we do once a year to speak about issues that were important to him, to keep his legacy alive, and also to continue with the education that he was so passionate about teaching here. So Brian Kelly, actually I first wanted to start off by acknowledging any family, friends, colleagues, or students of his who came this evening. We appreciate your support in coming out. Brian had a storied career, and everybody who was touched by him, whether it was through class or work, or even just as a friend, was very blessed. So I'll start out by saying a little bit about Brian Kelly. He spent 20 years in the Air Force working in intelligence, and then he moved on to the CIA after that for several years. And the former press secretary for the CIA, George Little, has called him a national treasure. He retired from the CIA in 2006. And I guess just a little bit of background on him for those of you who don't know him. Part of what defined him as a person was his experience towards the end of his career at CIA, where he was accused of being a spy. He had a couple pretty hellish years being interrogated, followed by members of the government, people trying to get him to confess to something that he did not do. And that spy turned out to be Robert Hansen. So when that saga ended, he could have done two things. He could have gone public and criticized the agency and the government and made a big debacle of it, or he could have taken the high road, which he chose. He didn't choose to publicly go after anyone in the CIA or other government agencies. He instead wanted to dedicate his life to the rest of his life to not having something like that happen again to others. So next we will all speak briefly about Eugene Poteat. He's our speaker this evening. He knew Brian Kelly very well. Eugene Poteat is a retired CIA intelligence officer. He also served as the president of the Association of Former Intelligence Officers for many years. And he has at least one degree that I know of from IWP. Still going to school. He actually mentioned just before the lecture, when he goes on vacation, he takes classes, he goes to school. So that says something about his passion for education. Among the places that Eugene Poteat worked, he's worked as a scientist for the CIA, for the Director of Science and Technology, and for the National Reconnaissance Office. Dr. Poteat, take it away.
Can I be heard all the way in the back? Doesn't work back there fine. That's good. The American Revolutionary War was known as the shot heard around the world. The small group of colonists fighting under George Washington defeated the world's greatest empire at the time. But shortly after that war, James Fenimore Cooper wrote the first great American novel. It was entitled The Spy. And the story was about a man named Enoch Crosby. Enoch Crosby had been one of George Washington's key counterintelligence or counterespionage officers. But he was thought to have been a traitor because all of his friends and family and everyone thought that Enoch Crosby was a traitor because he was working too closely with the English at the time. But he paid the price. He was condemned by family and friend and everyone for his work at the time. But interestingly, the best books, the great stories about, great books about spies are not about spies. It's about catching the spy or counter-espionage. That's what good spy novels are about. But in the counterintelligence world, things are very, very murky. The famous wilderness of mirrors you may have heard about. Enoch Crosby was suspected of being a traitor working for the British, and he suffered condemnation from family and friends. The complexity of the plots in spy versus spy thrillers tells just how difficult, tricky, and controversial counterintelligence really is. Sometimes it takes the smallest, seemingly insignificant detail and even the right nose, instinct and intuition, hard work, and at times just plain dumb luck to catch the spy. And in this tricky world, there are only a few great experts in the business. Brian Kelly was one of our top-notch experienced counterintelligence officers, but he suffered the same condemnation that was thought, they thought, he was thought to be a traitor to his country. He was hunted and harassed for it. It's important that you know the story about Brian Kelly, because we're going to honor him this evening. Now here's what happened. The CIA had penetrated the tight security of the Soviet Union, which was a counterintelligence state. And the CIA had several assets, senior Russian officials providing CIA critical secrets. But suddenly these assets began to disappear. They were being picked up, arrested, and executed. It's clear there had to be a mole inside the intelligence community, most likely inside the CIA. Someone was tipping off Russian KGB. The FBI was in charge of the mole hunt. Circumstantial evidence like people's habits, travel patterns, their age, their access, their financials led the FBI to suspect Brian Kelly, a CIA counterintelligence officer. Kelly was secretly surveilled. His friends and family were harassed, and he was ostracized by former colleagues. And eventually, he was put on leave from the CIA in order to ramp up the pressure on him. But oddly, Brian Kelly passed every effort by the FBI to target him as a traitor. He passed their polygraph test and every trick used to out him, including an FBI agent posing as a Russian who knocked on Brian's home door, offered him money and help to flee the country to escape the FBI inquiry. All of that effort failed. The FBI was bewildered that Kelly wouldn't bite. Worse, Brian Dudith reported each provocation to the CIA security people. With Brian not responding to these inducements and tricks, in desperation, the FBI offered a large sum of money to the Russian FBI agents that might be able to provide information of value and help identify the mole. Guess what? It worked. A Russian officer came forward with a bag of stolen documents that the traitor had provided to the KGB. But looking at all the documents that had been stolen did not help identify the traitor. The FBI had paid $7 million. That was money well spent. The files were a great interest, of course, showing what was stolen, but they did not identify who the thief or traitor was. Many had access to all the documents that were being passed to the Russians, but also the package that was given to the FBI contained an audio recording of the traitor's voice when he was talking to his KGB Russian handler. Along with these material that was in a black plastic bag that the traitor had been used to hide in for a dead drop to be picked up by the Russians. But this tape sparked a lot of keen interest. The FBI team played the tapes over and over, listening carefully. And some of them were haunted by the familiarity of the voice on that audio tape. Which possible CIA officer could the mole be? You have no idea what went on in those conversations until one of the FBI men reluctantly and in horror blurted out, "I know that voice. It's our Bob Hansen down the hall." Hansen, a senior FBI official, was someone the panel would never have suspected. Even with the audio ID, it was hard for the FBI to accept that one of their own was the culprit. It wasn't until the FBI finally were convinced that it was Hansen, one of their own, and Brian Kelly was finally vindicated. So what was Brian's reaction to all of this? Was it revenge against all those that had accused him? No. He was a counterintelligence expert's expert, and he knew that connecting the dots does not always lead to the right answer. Instead, he stayed calm. He refused to let his life be consumed by bitterness, and he quietly put his life back together, mainly thanks to his smart lawyer wife, Trish, who is here with us this evening. And most of important, Brian began a new career to educate counterintelligence officers about the pitfalls awaiting them, using his own experience as one of the many lessons He even became an IWP professor, imparting the type of firsthand expertise one only gets at this remarkable institution of IWP. Was it the strain of the pressure? Probably, for Brian unexpectedly died a couple of years ago, too young to have left us. If you want to know what the word legacy should mean, think of Brian Kelly. And counterintelligence is more important today, now more than ever, with Russia and China going all out to steal secrets, our technology, our personal communications, and including even our democracy. They're using all the traditional tools plus cyber warfare to steal, distract, circumvent, or destroy our technology, advances, and our democracy. They're also attacking using propaganda and fake news. But this is not new, by the way. The KGB has been doing this for decades. In prior years, they spread the word that CIA was kidnapping children in South America for body parts to be used in transplants in the United States. They were accused of concocting AIDS in a U.S. laboratory. they sold, that the CIA was selling crack cocaine to blacks in the ghettos of Los Angeles, and scores of other inflammatory, fictitious myths to include distrust. And it often worked. As clever propaganda always does, it can work. And it worked because intelligence agencies have made mistakes in the past enough that people don't want to forget. It worked because intelligence agencies made such mistakes as missing the missile bomber gap between the U.S. and Russia, the absence of WMDs in Iraq, missed understanding predicting 9/11, San Bernardino, the Boston pressure cooker bomb massacre, Orlando shootings, and more. It is an imperfect business. And on this note, if there's anything I would like you to take away from what I've just said, it is one that Brian Kelly would also impart to you. Carefully verify things you believe, even if you're certain of them, before repeating them, writing them, broadcasting them, whispering them, to avoid the myths hurting people, putting yourself, your credibility, your career, your family, agency, or country at risk due to repeated falsehoods. And one way to avoid that is precisely what you're doing here at IWP. You're becoming meticulous, informed scholars at this amazing institution where you meet professors, and I see some of them here, then practitioners who have walked the walk, and they share their real world in history. Use it wisely, just as Brian Kelly did for all of us. I think the most interesting part of any event like this at IWP is our questions and answers session. So I'm going to cut this off at this point and ask you, if you have any questions, write them down, and I think they'll be passed forward. We'll see what we can do to answer some of them for you. Do you have any? The wife and Lord, would you please stand up and be recognized? Yes, if you want to say something, go ahead, please.
First of all, I apologize for being late. Gene did a wonderful presentation. He really touched on all of the turmoil that the family went through. Brian was under surveillance for 4 years, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, including helicopters. Of course, he didn't know that he was under that surveillance because he didn't do anything wrong. So it was quite a turmoil for the family and for Brian in particular. And he's probably the only person who's ever been accused of a espionage crime that carried a capital punishment for 18 months. Thank God it wasn't 18 years, but 18 months he was out in the cold. It was the $7 million package that the FBI, I think, thought they were going to, be able to say it really was Brian Kelly who was the biggest spy of the 20th century, but it was that package that exonerated him, probably the only person's ever gone back to the agency that was accused of espionage and went back, and that was more important to him. It was extremely important to him. This is why he loved this place here. He loved IWP. But it was extremely important to him for him to be able to teach counterintelligence and hopefully impart, some of the lessons learned through his case and other case studies. And he was probably the Pied Piper of counterintelligence, I would say. Many of you out here knew him. And you probably would agree with me that he probably was the Pied Piper. Everybody kind of lined up behind him. So thank you so much, IWP. You're wonderful. If you've got a question.
Just wait for the mic if you could.
Thank you. I was interested in how you represent him.
I didn't represent him. I was his wife. I am an attorney, but I did not represent him. He really didn't. He didn't sue the government at all. Didn't sue the agency. Didn't sue the FBI. Didn't sue the United States government. Didn't sue anybody, because it was more important for him to go back to Langley and do his job. And so he was very satisfied with that. He was very happy to be here and happy to impart that knowledge to the students. And you know, you students out there are the next generation of the Brian Kellys of the world and the case officers, you know, that protect our country. And he really enjoyed doing that. And I wish all of you a lot of luck and best wishes on your career in this field. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Poteat, I just had a quick question for you. Can you just talk a little bit more about how you think the role of intelligence has changed from when you were in government versus what you can see from the outside now?
If you had expected a political talk dealing with the current situation in our country, I made every effort to avoid that subject as best I could. But I would like to say something. All of these supposed mistakes in the past, it turns out there's a major change that occurred at 9/11. It turned out the intelligence community had realized some changes had to be made. The Congress passed a law that dictated changes in the intelligence community and how their assessments and analysis was done, specifically done to avoid politics entering into it at all. Everyone's very familiar with the famous phrase, it was a slam dunk, when the CIA claimed there were WMDs in Iraq. But there was plenty of evidence that that was not the case. There were those inside the CIA that well knew there were no WMDs in Iraq. But that did not keep the director, George Tenet, from making his famous statement that it's a slam dunk, there's WMDs there. That was one of the big, Colin Powell repeated that statement in a speech at the UN, but later when he realized it was not true, he said it was the worst mistake of his life making that speech. It's interesting that there was evidence, so it's obvious that, well, I believe, that George Tenet knew perhaps what the White House wanted to hear, and that law after 9/11 that changes and organizes requires a new way of doing analysis and presenting it to ensure that politics do not creep in to the process of analysis and assessments. Furthermore, the Director of National Intelligence emphasized and added to that by creating a new intelligence directive for the entire intelligence community, directive, I think it was 302. But this directive was very, very specific. You had to document everything you put into an intelligence assessment and so on. So there is a good effort since 9/11. I believe the chances of politics getting into any CIA assessment is virtually over. Now, a lot of people want to wait to see if that's the case, but I think they've taken all the proper steps to ensure to avoid politics.
Just so we can make it a little easier, we're going to just take the questions from the comment card. So if you've got questions, if you can write them down and pass them forward, or we'll have someone come around and collect them, and he'll answer the questions that way. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I'll have that repeat so they know what the question is.
How do I assess the counterintelligence threat from terrorist organizations? I'm not in the assessment business, but you get my opinions of that based on my experience being associated with or near it. The most difficult threat assessment that we have faced is what we face today. Terrorist organizations are ubiquitous. They're everywhere. They don't wear uniforms. They don't have armies that we recognize it. They don't have air forces, marines, and so on. They're among us. They're everywhere. So the terrorist is the greatest threat. I think I can give you the best case why it's much more difficult today, and that is 9/11. It turns out that on the morning of 9/11, I got a telephone call at 9 o'clock in the morning. I was home with my feet on my kitchen table having a second cup of coffee, and it turned out the phone rang, and I answered it, and it was a friend of mine from the Associated Press. He said, "Gene, is your television on?" And I said, "Well, yes, but I never listen to or watch it." He said, "Please look at your TV and tell me what you see." I turned around and looked at the TV, and I saw that first tower in New York burning. And while I was watching the TV, I saw the second airplane fly into the second tower. He said, "What in the world kind of an accident is that?" And I said, "Well, it's obvious it is not an accident." Because he said, "Well, how do you know that?" I said, "Well, it's clear weather, and there's two of them. And besides, no airline pilot would do that, even with a gun to his head. Second, it's a terrorist attack. And the terrorists are trained in flying their own airplanes." And he said, "You mean to tell me that they've got people that trained in this country, and that they are terrorists?" And I said, "Yes, absolutely." So it was impossible to predict something that's never been done before. However, the terrorism is the most difficult, I think, counterintelligence threat. You don't know who they are, where they are, and they're difficult to find. Mission impossible. If you think it's difficult to track down, if you know that a Russian might be a spy, that's one matter. But trying to identify who's a terrorist, that is near mission impossible. However, there's progress being made. I remember when I called that afternoon on 9/11, I called the FBI, and I wanted to report to them that I knew where they could find the pilots, the terrorist pilots. They've all been learning to fly airplanes in the U.S., checked the flying schools. And when I identified one specific young man that was a lifeguard at our health club, and he was a Saudi, and he turned out to be learning to fly. He wasn't interested in learning to take off and land. But I thought he was a nice young kid. You never would have suspected he was a potential terrorist. When I called the FBI, it took a long time to get someone on the phone, as you can imagine, that day. But when I did, I said, "I know where you might can find a possible one of the terrorists." And she said, "I'm sorry, I can't help you." "Well, what has he committed a crime yet?" And I said, "I don't know that." And she said, "Well, I cannot help you. The FBI is not allowed to do anything until after a crime is committed." That's changed today. But I think the most difficult assessing terrorism has another strange aspect of it. We now have everybody looking at the terrorism threat. We now have the military cooperating with the intelligence community. They're in the field. they're doing everything they can. It's an amazing effort, but I don't know that that there's a sure way of finding a terrorist at all. It's the most difficult job the country has. This is a standard question. What's the biggest challenge for the U.S. intelligence? I think that you've just heard some of that. It's identifying a terrorist before they can act. And that's a very difficult, virtually impossible to answer. You've got experts here that are much better qualified to answer that than am I. And you know who they are. They're CIA experts right here amongst you. Here's a good question that I'm more comfortable with than anything. And it says, can you talk a bit about the role, my role in the development of the U-2, the SR-71 Blackbird, and the reconnaissance spy satellites? Well, I was lucky. I was involved in all three of those projects from day one. As a matter of fact, intelligence, and here's the sad news. In those early days, 50s and 60s, the CIA did not have any spies inside the Soviet Union. The first spy that got in was after Gary Powers was shot down over Sverdlovsk, Russia. But nonetheless, I was very lucky. I was an electrical engineer, physicist, and I was hired by the CIA, by some people that recruited me out of Cape Canaveral, where I was working on developing missile guidance systems for ICBMs. And they wanted some expertise, and so they recruited me out of the CIA. And believe it or not, I left Florida and came to Washington, D.C. But basically, since there was no knowledge of what the Soviet Union, whether they were ahead of us, behind us, how many missiles or airplanes they had, it turned out there was only one way to get that answer. And President Eisenhower knew what that should be. He simply said, well, you have to go take a look at it. And he had brought together the leading academics in the country to help advise him. And they recommended that you simply build an airplane and that could fly high enough and far enough, overfly the Soviet Union, and take pictures and photograph everything they have. And that's what took place. And it answered the question. It brought back the critical answer of the day. The U.S. still has military superiority over the Soviet Union. Now, that's good to know. As a matter of fact, because of that knowledge, President John F. Kennedy told Khrushchev, I will stay in Berlin and will not back out. You can go fly a kite. Then when it came time to Russia moved missiles into the Cuba, again, it turned out that the answer was right there. Kennedy was able to tell Khrushchev and reach an agreement to withdraw missiles from Cuba and also our missiles from Turkey for one reason. We had military superiority, and that made the difference. Now, Khrushchev had known that, so he was no dummy. He realized he was outgunned if it came to fighting, so he was happy to pull out the missiles out of Cuba. So what you see is the, and by the way, the technology that the intelligence community developed, a new type of intelligence, high technology, airplanes, spy satellites, and so on, was the leading R&D establishment in the world at the time. Did you hear that? The leading science and technology R&D establishment anywhere. When they developed a satellite that could take a picture over the Middle East and have it back in Washington in seconds, the first digital camera in space. That's high tech, trust me. They also, in those early days, the technology was to develop the first ever stealth airplane, and that was carried out by the CIA. The predecessor to the 71 Blackbird was, in fact, to be the first stealth airplane. And that led to all the technology in use today around the world about stealth. So the technology, the development of all the high-tech, the drones, by the way, that are used today, that was all an early CIA development. So it was a fun time for we engineers. Here's an interesting question, a thing that is, we've worked around it. We talked a little bit about San Bernardino, Boston, 9/11, and Orlando. Do you feel that we are flawed in the way we do analysis? I think in years past, I mean decades ago, we had flawed analysis, and it was unfortunate. For example, when the Russians were putting missiles into Cuba during the Cuban Missile Crisis, the CIA analysts produced a national intelligence estimate that said the Russians would not dare put missiles into Cuba. That's bad analysis. And when they saw missiles in Cuba, had photographs of the missiles in Cuba, the analysis changed their mind. They said, well, okay, they're there, but the Soviets would never dare use them. That was bad analysis. But I think the new analysis today is as good as it's going to ever get. There's no politics involved. There's new regulations and laws that govern how analysis is done to keep politics out of it. So I think that's the best answer I can do there. I promise not to interfere with your reception, which will start shortly. Interesting. I think this is typical of what a student would like to know. The idea was, what would you impart to the next generation based on your experience to overcome organizational and cultural differences? I got to tell you something that, talk about fake news, and that is that the CIA and the FBI and the NSA never cooperated. They were rivals, if you will. Those days are long gone. It's over. It's not happening anymore. So I think that the organization, if you get a job working for DIA, FBI, CIA, or NGA, doesn't matter. You're part of the community. And I think the word community says it better than anything. Oh, this is interesting. They say, well, can all the new technology and the means of collection, technology, drones, satellites, replace the role of the man on the ground? Absolutely not. Basically, the only real information you'll ever get that's critical, inside information, what the enemy might be planning or thinking, comes from case officers, operations officers. It does not come from technology. The drone or the satellite can never see and hear what goes on inside. That only comes from the man on the ground, the case officer with an agent in place. That's the only way to answer that. Technology will never do it. It helps in a tactical situation once you're in a, it helps the military in war more than it does strategic intelligence. I got too many questions that seem to be very similar, but I think the answer is, again, this is an amazing place, and you've got practitioners, people who've walked the walk that are here teaching. You're very fortunate to be here in this institution. And by the way, I think I would like to close with one simple statement. I was the first graduate here. That's a long time ago. And when I left the CIA and was retiring, I wanted to increase my knowledge by getting graduate degrees that would help me in my new career working in business and so on in technology. I visited every key university on the East Coast looking for a good graduate school that I could attend. I went to Boston University. I did all the ones in Washington and so on. But then I picked up the Washington Post one day and I saw a small ad about the size of a postage stamp. And it had that eagle that you recognize here on it. And I looked at that very closely, and I said, my God, it lists four courses that are taught at a place called IWP. I looked at the courses, and I said, that's exactly what I would like to take. So I signed up for two courses. I picked something that I knew something about. One of them had to do with nuclear negotiations, nuclear warfare. Second one was counterintelligence. So I took those two courses, and I was surprised. I could evaluate them that way because I knew something about it. They were good courses, the best that could be had, and I continued to sign up to courses and became the first graduate of IWP. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks everyone for coming this evening. We have a certificate to present to Dr. Poteat for his speech today and for his service. So we're going to do a photo op, and then once we're done with that, we'll start the reception in the back if they're ready. Dr. Poteat, would you like to come up? Mrs. Kelly, too, as well. So I'll just read this real quick. It says, in recognition for all of his years of support and service to the alumni of the Institute of World Politics, the Alumni Association honors Eugene Poteat. The years of service and encouragement he has provided as a fellow alum, professor, and friend are invaluable to the strength of the alumni community, dated this day, 24th of February, 2017. So thank you very much, Dr. Poteat.